We know ventricle system is a complex non-planar partition with alternate well-defined contour and atomic landmark on the right side of the ventricle surface. So generally divide into membranous endless trabeculum and ventricle. Just this is a diagram showing the membranous outlet trabecular inlet septum. One of the few other names are subarterial or supracircuit, which are basically outlet. So the membrane system septum is divided by the tricuspid annulus into ventricular, atrial, and interventricular components, and that abut the three major segments of the muscular septum. Inlet, which is lightly trabeculated, trabecular system, which is highly trabeculated, and the infundibulum, which is non-trabeculated. The inlet septum is limited by the tensor attachment to tricuspid valve and is so named according to its location. The trabecular septum lies between the inlet and infundibulum, as seen in previous diagram. And atrioventricular conduction penetrates conduction tissue, penetrates the ventricle atrium component of the membrane system. And the bundle of Hess and bundle of branches run beneath the deficient interventricular component of the membranous septum close to the free edge of the ventricular septal defect. So it is the most common, VST is the most common congenital heart defect, excluding bicuspid aortic valve, and constitutes 20-30% of all congenital heart defects. And prevalence varies from 3 to 5 per live births, but more recent studies show higher prevalence due to ease of detection of smaller VSDs by ECHO. So coming to different types, approximately 80% are perimembranous, and basically perimembranous underscore the extension into adjacent portions of inlet trabecular and infundibular septum. Large membrane defects encroach upon all three portions of the muscular septum. The muscular ventricular septum defects are prevalent in units, estimates as every 1,000 births. Approximately 90% of the defects grows spontaneously within the first 10 months of life. And the most common types of muscular defects lie within the trabecular system. The malformations are more apparent on the left septal surface and vary from small to large, single to multiple, honeycombs and switch keys. Like structure with sieve-like fenestration to tortuous sinusoidal tracts threading among the septal trabeculae without through and through perforations. And these sieve-like fenestration multiple small muscular defects have net functional effect of a single large defect. So isolated defects in the inlet septum represent approximately 8%. Inlet VSDs is bordered by entirely by the myocardium and differs from inlet defect that involves the basal portion of the septum near the crux, where it is partially bordered by the bridging atrioventricular tissue. The infundibular septum is represented by a small portion of the muscle interposed between the outflow components of the left and right ventricles. Sleeve of subpulmonary infundibulum supports the leaflets of the pulmonary band and separates the right ventricle outflow tract from the surface of the heart rather than from the left ventricle outflow tract. So these ventricular septal defects in the infundibulum are also called supracircuit, subpulmonary, subarterial, or double committed, and account to 5-7% in North America and Europe, but it is approximately 30% in Asians. Much more common in Asians. Infundibular septal defects can be entirely muscular or can be partially rimmed by seminal valve tissue, which are called subarterial. Coming to doubly committed subarterial, little or no muscle is interposed between the outflow components of the left and right ventricles, and when there is absence of septal component of subpulmonary infundibulum. And so the aortic and the pulmonary leaflets are in fibrous continuity. and these defects lie immediately beneath the valve of both the arterial trunk. So left and right coronary cuffs of the aortic valve tend to prolapse into the outflow tract of the right ventricle. Much less commonly, the pulmonary cusp might prolapse with the defect. Coming to atrioventricular septum malalignment, it necessarily involves an inlet ventricular septal defect and usually accompanied by straddling of the tensor apparatus of an AV valve that inserts on both sides of the ventricular septum. And the so-called Eisenmenger's malalignment represents the perimembranous ventricular septal defect with anterior deviation of the infundibular septum. Coming to closure rates, the incidence of spontaneous closure is about 50-75% for restrictive perimembranous and trabecular muscular defects observed from birth. The incidence rates of trabecular muscular defects are reportedly equal or somewhat higher than that of perimembranous. Moderately restrictive and non-restrictive also flow spontaneously, but the probability is low, 5-10% approximately. And most defects that are destined to close do so within the first year of life, with approximately 60% closing by 3rd year of age, 90% closing by 8th year of age. But late closure has also been seen. Now, spontaneous closure in the muscular trabecular septums are generally funnel shaped and with a sealed orifice on the right ventricular septum and the residual patency on the left ventricular septum. And with endocardial proliferation, the lumen of lumen and hypertrophy around the head. Muscular defects, which represent switch seized variety, do not close spontaneously. And defects in the inlet septum decrease in the size but are occasionally included by bridging heavy valve, heavy tissue. Infundibular defects can close by prolapse of the right aortic cusp. And these perimembranous ventricular septum defects close by either adherence of the septal tricuspid leaflet to the margin of the defect, the less commonly by prolapse of an aortic cusp, or rarely by intrusion of sinus of Golgi. Adherence of the tricuspid leaflet is seldom completed by TR, but there is a tendency for aneurysm formation when a perimembranous defect are closed by a tricuspid valve. So this is a autogram. This is a left ventricular trunk of 9-year-old child with a perimembranous BSD. And we can see there is a septal aneurysm, and we can also see the small shunt with the coming from. Yeah. Coming to ventricular septal aneurysms, they are as a rule relatively small. Exceptionally, they can be expanded to considerable size and even can be perceived as mediastinal mass. Blind septal aneurysm occasionally represents a sui generis nucleus, rather than consequence, it is a congenital malformation of the interventricular or the membranous septum rather than a sequel of the spontaneous closure of the veins. They are familial congenital septal aneurysms also, though rare. With notable exceptions, they are generally built obliterated. Complications can occur, which can be infective endocarditis, conduction disturbances, intra-aneurysm thrombosis, and subsequent systemic embolism. Aortic and tricuspid regurgitation, obstruction of RV outflow, blind congenital aneurysm may also spontaneously perforate sometimes, establishing a left to right shunt into either the right ventricle or right atrium, but significantly different. Coming to hemodynamic classification, hemodynamically, VSDs can be divided into because of the physiological consequences depend upon the size of the defect and the pulmonary vascular resistance. And these two variables change with time and pathological and clinical manifestations change accordingly. So when the resistant limits or restricts left to right shunt, then we say it is a restrictive defect. And there the left ventricular systolic pressure is higher than the right ventricular systolic pressure. And these defects include those with normal right ventricular systolic pressure and those with elevated but less than systemic left ventricular systolic pressure. When the left to right shunt is not restricted at the site of the defect, the term is called as non-restrictive. And here the RV and LV systolic pressures and therefore pulmonary artery and aortic systolic pressures are identical. So the magnitude of the left to right shunt is governed by pulmonary vascular resistance. Coming to anatomic and physiologic type, it can be divided into grossly four categories. First is restricted defects, which have normal RV and pulmonary artery systolic pressures, normal PVR. Moderately restricted defects with elevated RV and pulmonary artery pressures, and low but variable pulmonary vascular resistance. Coming to non-restricted defects with identical LV and RV systolic pressures, but subsystemic PVR, which could be variable, and non-restricted defects with identical pressure but suprasystemic PVR and right to the ventricle, which we know now as isomerism syndrome. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the four categories. So they can be also classified according to size. Small size, which can be defined as diameter of the defect, where it is less than one third of the size of the aortic orifice. The RV and the pulmonary artery pressure are normal. Left to right shunt is less than 1.5:1. And left side chamber is normal in size. Moderate VSD, in restrictive, where diameter of the defect is more than one third, but less than the size of the aortic orifice. And the RV and the PA pressures varies from normal to two-thirds of systemic pressure. And shunt is more than 1.5:1 and left chambers are dilated. Large VSD non-restrictive, where the diameter of the defect is equal or more than the aortic size, RV pulmonary artery pressures are systemic or non-systemic, and degree of left to right shunt depends on the PVR. The left sided cardiac chamber is dilated and PVR is normal or minor. Coming to smaller sector defects, also known as malady derider, they cause little functional derangement because the shunt is small and the pressure and resistance of the pulmonary circulation are normal. The resistive defects represent the site of obligatory resistance between the left and right ventricle, thus limiting or restricting the magnitude of the left to right shunt. And including delivery of the left ventricular systolic pressure into RV and pulmonary artery trunk. Shunt is generally in systole. Minor diastolic flow is generated by the normal difference in left ventricular and right ventricular distensibility and diastolic pressures. Moderately restrict VSDs. They are characterized by RV pressures that are above normal but less than systemic and have variable pulmonary vascular resistance, but they generally rarely progress. The left ventricle adapts to the moderate increase in volume and right ventricle adapts to the moderate increase in pressure. Instant to instant right to left shunting occurs because the LV systolic pressure falls more rapidly than the RV systolic pressure. But however, the left ventricular systolic pressure rises more rapidly than the RV. So the small right to left shunts are quantitatively returned to the right ventricle in the next article. An increase in diastolic.
Any, Can you go to the previous slide? Can you explain the last statement?
Sir, they are saying that there is instant right to left shunting, because normally what the right ventricle systolic pressure falls more rapidly. So at some point, the RV systolic pressures might be more than LV systolic pressures, because LV systolic pressure falls more rapidly. So for a moment, there might be some right to left shunt. But due to the fact that LV systolic pressure also rise more rapidly, hence whatever has come in the previous cycle goes back in the next cycle because of this right.
Yeah, because the DPDT of rise of left ventricle pressure is faster, and fall of the right ventricular is faster. So there will be a point when RV pressure is transiently over more than the left ventricular pressure. When the ventricle is contracting, there will be a point when the ventricle is relaxing. There will be a point when the left ventricular pressure will more than the, significantly more, even if there is no resistance, when the ventricle is contracting in systole. Understand? LV ka pressure jyada teji se rise karta hai aur RV ka pressure jyada teji se fall karta hai.
नहीं सर, LV का फॉल भी ज्यादा तेजी से कर रहा है, तभी ज्यादा तेजी से फॉल करेगा, कभी थोड़ी देर के लिए RV प्रेशर ज्यादा होगा.
लेफ्ट वेंट्रिकल सिस्टोलिक प्रेशर जो है, इट फॉल्स, यू मीन टू से, मोर देन द आरवी प्रेशर. अगर वो फॉल करेगा तो एट सम, ओह यस यस, हां तभी आरवी का प्रेशर, क्योंकि वो फॉल ज्यादा करे, इज फास्टर. नो, डीपीडीटी ऑफ LV इज ऑलमोस्ट मोर देन द राइट वेंट्रिकल. ओके, आई एग्री. DPDT of the left ventricle is always more than the right ventricle. It increases fast and it decreases fast. Yeah, you're right. So that is the reason, at some point of time, the LV pressures would go some much below than the right ventricle pressure. Because cardiac cycle to utni hai na, utni cardiac cycle, utni minute mein LV ko bhi contract karna hai aur RV ko bhi karna hai. So you can imagine to go from 4 to 120 versus going from 4 to 25. So naturally, rise of LV is more. Similarly, they have to come down from 25 to 4. So definitely, rise and fall of LV is always faster. Right? Thank you. Yes. Okay. Yes.
Okay. So an increase in end-diastolic pressure in the volume overloaded left ventricle results in diastolic shunting muscle. So moderately restrict defects in the trabecular muscular septum decrease in size during the ventricle contraction, and in doing so, they decrease the systolic shunt. With isotonic exercise, the systemic vascular resistance falls, while the pulmonary vascular resistance changes little, if at all. So, normal increment in systemic flow is achieved without a corresponding increase in left to right shunt. With isotonic exercise. Coming to non-restrictive ventricular septal defects. With non-restrictive defects, right and left pressure behave physiologically as a common genome. The peak systemic systolic pressures are identical. So the volume and direction of the flow through the defect depends on the relative resistance of the pulmonary and systemic circulation. Non-restrictive defect with elevated but variable pulmonary vascular resistance imposes an excessive load on the left ventricle and systemic afterload on the right ventricle. A persistently large left to right shunt culminates in depressed systolic function of the volume overloaded LV. And a rise in pulmonary vascular resistance results in reciprocal fall in the left to right shunt, if you know, and a comparable reduction in the volume overload of the left ventricle. But the systolic pressure in two ventricles necessarily remains the same. When the pulmonary vascular resistance is suprasystemic, the architecture of the pulmonary vascular beds resembles primary pulmonary hypertension, and left to right shunt is replaced by right to left shunt. The right ventricle function is analogous to the function of a fetal right ventricle but which is more equipped to cope with the SVR. The vasoreactor reactor mature pulmonary vessels play a pivotal role regulating pulmonary blood flow in the neonates with a non-restrictive VSD. The physiologic fall in neonatal pulmonary vascular resistance is delayed because of the interplay between the shunt cell and pulmonary vasoreactor. So this is basically just shortened form of the pathophysiology network. Associate defects, left heart can be aortic stenosis, coarctation, TAR, DRB, truncus, sometimes singular ventricular tractus, trigger, ELV. Chromosomal disorders, trisomy 21 in 40% patients have PSC, and trisomy 13 and 18, they have 18% and 31% respectively. In 22q11 deletion, TAR is most common, but VSD without aortic arch anomaly is second most common. And Goldorin, also known as iron heart syndrome, is also associated with VSD. The recurrent risk of VSD is based on paternal VSD. We can say paternal is parental VSD. Paternal is 2%, maternal is 10%. So, coming to history, the incidence in humans is unrelated to gender, race, maternal age, or birth order. The ventricle septal defects have been reported in 3.3% of the first degree relatives of the index patient. 1/3 of the first degree relatives of the patient with CHD have VSD. 30 to 60% of the sibling of the index patient have VSDs. And siblings of the patient with VSDs have 3 times the incidence of VSDs compared to general population. All this is confusing, but VSDs have been reported in atypical twins, but there is a high incidence of high frequency of response. Parent with a spontaneously caused VSD can have an offspring with a VSD. Birth rates are low in about 18% of full-term patients with VSD. This maturity, in addition to and apart from the occurrence of VSD premature infants and heterochromy, coming to restrictive VSDs, they generally come to light because of a systolic murmur detected in the first 12 baby examination. Murmur that is present at birth is a feature of VST with left to right, LV to RA communication, in which the shunt exists in U2 and is therefore present at birth. Very small but real early systolic shunts may escape detection because they are generally soft and might be mistaken for an innocent. The patient is left with no shunt and a functionally normal heart that harbors a pathological abnormality, especially a spontaneous closure is followed by septal aneurysm. The defect is necessarily missed if physical examination is performed after spontaneous closure. Okay, so coming to infective endocarditis, this tangible risk in restrictive septal defects, but rarely occurs before. Infective endocarditis is usually located on the septal tricuspid leaflet at the site of the jet impact. Muscular defects have the low incidence of infective endocarditis because the jet is dissipated within the RV without striking the septal leaflet. And occasionally, the site of infective endocarditis is on aneurysm of ventricular septum, or rarely vegetation at the base of the septal leaflet is called perforation, and left ventricular atrium, right atrium shunt might be there, which is called an acquired septum.
So if you have to take a history, if you're taking a history, family history is important because 50% of the first degree relatives can have first degree siblings can have a VSD. And this is important. लो बर्थ वेट हिस्ट्री व्हेन यू टेक द वेदर चाइल्ड वाज लो बर्थ वेट इट इज नॉट वेरी कॉमन लो बर्थ वेट इज जनरली नॉट कॉमन इट इज सीन इन ओनली 20% 18% यू सेड 18-20% सो लो बर्थ वेट आर जस्ट 18% मोस्ट ऑफ देम आर नॉर्मल बर्थ वेट फर्स्ट डिग्री सिबलिंग कैन हैव दिस इन ऑलमोस्ट 50% दिस इज द टू मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट यू हैव टोल्ड whenever there is a restrictive VSD it is not going to manifest at birth if you are getting a murmur of VSD it is most likely an obligatory shunt that means there is a significant pressure difference between the LV and the chamber that other chamber can only be atria because your perimembranous area is divided into two parts no right. So one is a ventriculo atrial communication which is called commonly called Gerbode defect so that is more likely to otherwise a VSD is not likely to cause murmur at birth. Infective endocarditis, you said that it is more common when there is eruption of the second teeth. So that means when the teeth start erupting, then you expect them. So it is very rare to have it before, and it is generally seen in jet areas. So most of the restrictive VSDs, the jet is hitting the tricuspid valve, perimembranous. So it is generally found across the tricuspid valve. In muscular VSDs, the incidence is not high because muscular VSDs tends to spread out in the RV cavity, so there is a no specific jet effect, so that it can localize. Also, because there is an inflow which is coming in, so the area is getting repeatedly. There is no nidus which can actually form in that particular area. So it is much more common in perimembranous locations. Okay, so this is for the restrictive VSD, moderate restrictive VSD.
Now coming to moderate restrictive VSDs. With low but variable PDR, so they also escape detection in newborn because there is a delayed fall in ultra coronary vascular resistance, which delays the onset of the shunt and the murmur. CHF within the first few months of life is in response to large left to right shunt that is established after the fall of PDR, and generally the infant fatigues and coughs while feeding, sweating excessively, is restless when they come in.
What are the go to the symptoms? What are the causes of all these symptoms? One, cough when feeding. No.
Yes, sir.
So why does it cough when feed? Fatigues and coughs while feeding. Why?
So feeding because coordination between feeding and breathing is.
Because of hypoxemia. So cough is an isotonic exercise, which is equivalent to isotonic exercise in adults, so which increases the filling pressures.
Have cough.
SVR falls. When you do an isotonic exercise, the SVR falls. Yes, and there is no change in PVR. Change this is PVR. What happens with the isotonic exercise.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so there is no increase in left to right shunt, only the change is in systemic flows which increase.
Yes,
but so, what happens with feeding?
So feeding is kind of exercise for the baby. So, but why
he gets tired cough? Easily, the output falls and then he pants and then becomes hungry again. Why does he sweat excessively? Because of the autonomic response. Why is he restless? Because the child is restless because he is hungry, he is most of the time not able to take enough in one feed. Because of basically these two factors which are doing. Now, one, the cardiac output which is compromised, and two, increased flow leading to increased flow in the lungs. So, the lungs are already flooded. So, any particular for whenever he has to feed, he has to transiently hold the breath. So definitely, okay. He is not able to hold it for long time because lungs are already flooded. When he sleeps poorly, because this year we already discussed because he's hungry. So everything is linked, no?
Right.
What else? Moderate.
Parents will detect a thrill when they touch the infant's chest. May detect a hyperactive precordium when the baby. Symptomatic improvement is related to generally spontaneous decrease in the size of the head. The patients with moderately restrictive defects and moderate left to right shunts tolerate isotonic exercises because the exercise induced increment in systemic blood flow is achieved without corresponding increase in shunt flow. And lower, however, the persistence of a significant shunt increases the risk of infective endocarditis. And protracted volume overload of the LV increases the risk of CHF. Only an occasional patient achieves atherectomy. Coming to non-restricted VSD with elevated but variable PVR. They present in infancy with CHF and with central prospect and it affects with decrease in size, both growth and development, labored breathing, frequent lower respiratory tract infections, typical feeding, excessive diaphoresis, as we discussed now. Dyspnea and irritability are especially pronounced when the infant is supine and improved when the baby is held upright or is placed in an infant seat. What I said, a hungry infant wakes from a fitful sleep and feeds vigorously only to stop short of satisfaction because of dyspnea and falls asleep again, exhausted by the effort, and awakens with renewed hunger and disease at the same time.
Let me talk this in. What is happening? Same thing you are raising again, no? When the child is feeding, whenever he is feeding, it is like an isotonic exercise, as Mohit is saying, no? So when he does the isotonic exercise, the cardiac output does not fall. Cardiac output is compromised. But cardiac output increases at the cost of increased shunt. The LV contractility is going to increase. It is to compensate, he had to increase the LV contractility. LV contractility increases, heart rate increases. Heart rate increases, autonomic symptoms.